Good morning. Please rise for the posting of the colors. I'd like to call on Reverend Peter Thompson for the invocation.
I invite you to join me as you are comfortable in a spirit of prayer. Holy and resilient one, steady and sure, you answer to many names, and your beauty and strength endure even through dust and rubble. We gather to acknowledge the horror of this day 17 years ago, to remember those who lost their lives, and to honor those who risked their lives to save the lives of others. Deal tenderly with our hearts as we awaken our memories. Soothe the pain that still lingers deep within. Bolster the defenses we have built to protect ourselves. And grant us the imagination and the generosity to transform our loss into love. That where devastation and desolation once reigned, hope and courage may flourish. And that the fragments of this broken world, which so often seems beyond repair, may be patched together by our efforts into a tapestry of kindness and peace. We pray this in the confidence that you hear us. Amen.
Please be seated. Thank you all for attending this day, the 17th anniversary of one of the most horrific days in our country's history. We always talk about never forget. Who can ever forget where we were when we first heard the news of the attacks on the World Trade Center and the Pentagon and the plane crash in Shanksville, Pennsylvania? Who can ever forget the pictures of innocent people fleeing the World Trade Center towers, running for their lives moments before the towers collapsed? Who can ever forget the first responders running up the stairs, doing their best to save people that they had never met in their lives, knowing full well that they most likely would not be returning? But that didn't dissuade them from their duties. They continued up those stairs, doing their sworn duty to protect lives at all costs. Who can ever forget the heroes that rose out of the rubble that day? Police and firefighters, people in uniform, but also those out of uniform, people who had no sworn duty to try to protect any lives except their own. Yet, many people helped others down the stairs, people who couldn't get down the stairs on their own. And as a result of that, many of those people lost their lives. So it is proper and fitting that we never forget. And it's also proper and fitting that we never forget the families that were left behind that day. People who lost loved ones. People who sent them off to work in the morning with a goodbye kiss, a hug. I'll see you later, Daddy. Hurry home, Mom. Not knowing at that moment that they would never see their loved ones again. So it is proper and fitting that we say, never forget the 2,996 men and women who perished that day at the World Trade Center, the Pentagon, and the failed attack on the White House by the heroes who stopped the plane that had turned and headed towards Washington, D.C., and crashed in Shanksville, Pennsylvania. God bless them all, and may they rest in peace. It is now my honor to call our good friend to the podium, Senator Blumenthal.
Thanks, Mayor Rilling, and thank you all for reminding us what is really important about this day, what's important about being an American on 9/11. In the couple of days after that horrific searing experience, we came together in this hall. I remember it vividly. The hall was full, literally, because we came together for comfort and courage, for grieving, in determination, but also apprehension about our future. We were under attack, literally under attack, and we came together as a nation in grief and in resolve. And I said then that the forces of terror have hit the Pentagon, they've destroyed the World Trade Center, but they missed America. They missed what is important about America. And that's what brings us together again today, to recognize that we are one nation. There is nothing we are incapable of doing if we are one nation, united. And so if I have a prayer and a hope for this day, it is that we come together even more than we have, because we've lost so much over these 17 years. Men and women whose lives were sacrificed abroad in the service of our nation. Men and women who went to the World Trade Center to help and to save others, who still suffer from the diseases, cancer, gastrointestinal disease, lethal conditions that even now the nation has failed to address. The Zadroga Act has passed Congress, but still inadequate funds are available to help those brave heroes who are alive today but suffer from those conditions. And still, we are divided about our determination to continue the war that must be sustained against the forces that threaten us. So I hope that we come together as a nation with respect for the rule of law, and most especially with thanks for the brave men and women, our police, our firefighters, our first responders, and our veterans who are here today. Thank you to our veterans. We must keep faith with you. We must leave no veteran behind. Thank you, every one of you, for being here today. And thank you, Mayor, for bringing us together. God bless our great country.
We are also joined this morning by U.S. Senator Chris Murphy.
Thank you very much, Mayor Rilling, for continuing this remembrance ceremony. I grew up about 2 hours from New York City in a small town outside of Hartford. And in our town, we lost three men that day. We lost a popular Little League coach, father of a close friend of mine, lost two young men that I went to school with. We were fairly far away, and so it was shocking to our community to lose three individuals. I cannot understand what it feels like to have 14 members of a community vanish off the face of the earth in one day, as happened here in Norwalk. But I also can't understand the kind of heroism that it took for so many first responders from this part of the state to make the decision that morning and that afternoon to rush to the scene of that devastation when so many were concerned with how we get out. And I guess when I wake up every morning on September 11th, I think about two things. I think first about the need that we have, the responsibility, the duty that we have to do more for our police, for our firefighters, for our emergency personnel, and to just pledge that we never, ever take for granted the blanket of safety that we live underneath that does not exist in so many other countries in the world because of what you all do. And when we were here last year, a storm was barreling down on southeastern United States. Another one is barreling down today. These moments of peril, we sleep a little bit more soundly at night because we know what you do. We know that you put your lives at risk for all of us. The second thing that I think about is that in those days afterwards, as Senator Blumenthal mentioned, what you saw is images of people of all political stripes, of all ethnic backgrounds coming together with a real sense that there was something that united us as Americans that was so much more important than all of the things that divide us. And obviously this anniversary falls every year in the political season, and it's just yet another reminder that our primary affiliation is as Americans. We may wear these jerseys for intramural scrimmages when we run for office, but in those days afterwards, it was our commitment to these universal ideas, the rule of law, the equality of man, the strength of diversity, that made us recognize that together there is absolutely nothing that we can't do. There is no one that can destroy us or cripple us as long as we're together. And when I wake up on these mornings, I think about my duty as an elected official to stand up for our police, our firefighters, our EMS, our soldiers, our sailors, our airmen, and our Marines. But I also think about trying to double down on that conversation about what defines us. Those were in those dark, dark days after September 11th, the moments that made us all proud. Thank you, Mayor Rilling. Thank you for all of Norwalk's public service employees for continuing to make us remember those things on this day.
Thank you, Senator Murphy. We are also joined by Congressman Jim Himes of the 4th Congressional District.
Thank you, Mayor. I feel privileged to join all of you, the senators, our mayor, common council, state representatives, chiefs, to remember this day 17 years later. I was working in Lower Manhattan 17 years ago and watched from a conference room window as the towers came down and the day disappeared into night. And like all of you, I went through a whole series of emotions more powerful than anything I'd ever experienced. First, shock and rage, and anger, and a sense of the need for retribution against those who had done this to us. And then as the day wore on, a sense of complete awe at the call to service of the people in uniform in Lower Manhattan. Our firefighters and our police officers nurture a sense of service in their heart, or they never would have put on those uniforms to begin with. But their training kicked in, and though they had never seen, as we had never seen, anything like what was happening, they ran into the core of the danger, and many of them, of course, never emerged. But what I choose to remember, because rage and anger and retribution are not things that we should carry around, what I choose to remember is what I saw as I walked up from Lower Manhattan to Grand Central to come back to Connecticut. And 6-7 hours after the attack, and the air is filled with ash and toxic chemicals and a smell that I will never forget, every 2 or 3 blocks, New York's a pretty tough town. People are pretty focused on themselves, on the getting and spending and whatever it is that's important that day. Every 2 or 3 blocks, New Yorkers lining up around the block to give blood, or deli owners taking all of their inventory, bananas and water and food, and just walking south knowing that there were people working down there. And just every block, New Yorkers saying, "How can I help? Are you okay?" And when that happens in New York, you know that something has been touched, something that may live deep within us most of the time, but that does live deep within each of us as Americans. And so that's what I choose to remember. Yeah, it's very, very important, first and foremost, to remember the victims, the 3,000-ish people that we lost in the three locations and their families who are still struggling with that pain, and of course the first responders who did what they did. But that's what I choose to remember, that in all of us as Americans, as people, is this instinct to, in the worst moment, to come together and to reach out and to try to offer comfort, a banana, a little bit of help, make sure we're okay, check in. I think on that day, it was very clear that that is who we are, and maybe that's who we should be. Thank you.
I think it proper and fitting at this time that we ask our police officers and our firefighters to stand, and let us say thank you to them for all that they do for us. We sleep safely at night knowing that they are on duty. Thank you to all of you. And now we will have a moment of silence followed by Norwalk Remembers Our Own.
Robert Walter Noonan, a Rowayton resident, Robbie is remembered each evening by his son Chance while picking out his father's stars in the heavens.
Derek James Statikevius. Derek always had a way of bringing joy and laughter into the most mundane of conversations.
Edwin J. Graff III, an outdoorsman at heart, Ed was an accomplished climber and mountaineer, and also a sub-3-hour marathoner.
Ronald Gilligan, his young friend wrote, "He was honestly a real genuine guy, more clever than all of us put together."
Adam Lewis, my brother, a father, a son, a grandson, a cousin, a husband, and a great friend. I miss him always. And it doesn't get easier every year. It's kind of difficult around this time because of the global nature of what happened. But I do remain hopeful that we will learn from 9/11 and everything else that has happened since then. But we haven't totally learned yet. It will take some time. And by celebrating our differences and coming together and working together, we accomplish so much more. I would like to wake up one day and have some peace on earth. Thank you to all the heroes of 9/11 and all the unsung heroes, like my brother, Adam Lewis.
George E. Spencer III, nicknamed Twig. He was an outdoorsman who loved biking, climbing, and sailing.
Thomas E. Hines. Tom was a great person and always wanted to be where everyone was, always ready to make people laugh and just feel good.
John Bentley Works. John always had his nose in a book. The Works were building a house in Rowayton, Connecticut, to house all of those books, as well as their 3-year-old Allison. He would climb a ladder to the third floor with his view of Long Island Sound. That floor was going to be his library.
Edward Francis Maloney III. Teddy developed a passion for several sports, including ice hockey, lacrosse, and football. He practiced for a time with his beloved New York Rangers.
William C. Hunt. Bill had a work hard, play hard attitude about life. He loved boating, skiing, traveling, and cooking, but most of all, he loved being with his family.
Bradley H. Vadas. Bradley loved to fish, ride jet skis, and play weekend baseball. His dad said he achieved a lot in his 37 years, and no one gave him anything. He ate a lot of spaghetti in college. What a great son he was.
James Matthew Patrick. James had just celebrated his first anniversary with his wife, Tara Lynn, and they were expecting their first child, a son. He was very excited about this baby.
Paul Dario Curioli. When he wasn't in the bleachers cheering on his teenage son's baseball or football teams, he could typically be found in the garage of his home, knee-deep in a woodworking project.
Cesar A. Murillo. Cesar was a 31-year-old Colombian native who grew up in Norwalk and made his home here until the year 2000 when he and his wife moved to New York.
guide us with your grace to a place where we'll be safe.
La luce che tu dai,
I pray we'll find your light.
Il cuore resterà,
and hold it in our hearts.
Ricordarci che
stars go out each night.
Thank you. We have been joined by Senator Duff. Senator, would you like to say a few words?
Good morning, everybody. My apologies for being tardy. I was in Darien at their 9/11 ceremony, which is a very different ceremony, two different communities and two very different ceremonies that they have. I think for all of us, and for me particularly, there are two events that in my lifetime that have struck me in my memory, one of which was the Challenger disaster, and the second was 9/11, and where we all were on that day. And outside of the images that we saw on TV and they unfolded, the image that strikes most in my mind is when my wife and I, we both worked in Greenwich at the time, were driving home together. For some coincidental reason, fateful reason, we drove to work that day together. And we saw the line of ambulances going down to New York City in the third lane of I-95 southbound, only to probably come back empty. And we think about what that meant that day for our country and those attacks and what meant for our region and the lives lost, the mothers, fathers, sons, and daughters who no longer came home that day. And we made a solemn promise that we would never forget their lives and their memories, and that we would always heed their memories and think about them each and every day. In addition, we always wanted to make sure that we held in our hearts the work that our police officers, our firefighters, our EMS do, not only on days like that when they run into buildings when we're running out, but the work that they do each and every day to keep us safe in our communities. So while 17 years ago, or in our first remembrances of this day, we may have had more people in this auditorium. We may have had others who found different ways to remember. We must always keep that promise that we made back in 2001 to never forget. So always pass down to our children and our grandchildren, our families, those who made sacrifices, the innocent ones who were lost, those who were heroes that day, and keep the tradition of fighting for our country, fighting for the values that we hold dear, and fighting for the memories of those who are lost. Thank you very much.
At this time, I would like to acknowledge the presence of a few people. Every year, the mother-in-law of Paul Curioli joins us. His wife, Kathy, joined us for a while, and just a short time ago, she lost her life after fighting a hard battle. So I want to acknowledge, from being here, thank you. I want to acknowledge Wilfredo Perez, whose son was deployed to Iraq, and he lost his life protecting our country and a children's hospital over at Iraq. Thank you for being here. We also have State Representative Gail Laviel, State Representative Chris Perrone, Councilman, excuse me, Greg Burnett. So at this time, excuse me, I will call upon Detective Christine Lepak for God Bless America. If you would all stand if you're able, and feel free to join in. God bless America. And while you're standing, if there are any veterans among us, people who serve this amazing country of ours, please raise your hand. Thank you. Thank you for your service. We're going to be retiring the colors now. If you would, gentlemen, retire the colors. Reverend Thompson.
Go in peace, for the dreams of the dead can live on in you. Go in peace, for the courage of the heroes can be your courage too. Go in peace, for you can build bridges with strength from above. Go in peace, for hate can be defeated with the power of your love. Amen. Thanks be to God.
Thank you for attending today. Before we retire for the day, I'd like to thank my city clerk, Donna King, for putting this program together. She did a great job, as she always does. I want to thank my staff, who also assisted. I'd like to thank Christina LePeck and David Foster for their wonderful rendition of the prayer. And yes, it's okay to give them a round of applause. And as we depart, may I say God bless you all, and may God bless this amazing, amazing nation that we so proudly call the United States of America. God bless.